So what about our own species? Human populations can be estimated all the way back to our first leaving of Africa. Population size of Homo sapiens increased about tenfold in the first 10,000 years that we were in Europe. This map shows a comparison between the number of Neanderthals that are estimated to have lived in France 45,000 years ago on the left, and these are relatively small communities. And remember, the Neanderthals had been there for a long, long time, and they still lived at very small communities. Within 10,000 years of the humans getting there, though, our populations were large, much larger than those of the Neanderthals. And it now seems that besides our interbreeding a bit with the Neanderthals, which really led to their extinction, was the fact that we crowded them out. We were much more successful at producing surviving offspring in Europe than were the Neanderthals. Now, one of the most important transitions in human history was going from hunter-gathering to agriculture. This happened about 11,000 years ago, and demographers have been able to estimate that with the advent of agriculture, having that stable food supply that we had control of, our population size grew rapidly because each family produced two additional children per woman. That's an enormous increase in family size with the advent of agriculture. If we look at estimates of human population size all around the world from 10,000 years ago to the present, we have a map here showing that the population has grown over the millennia and become more and more abundant in certain countries like India, China, Europe, and then North America. We see that the human population has exploded, mostly in the last few centuries. Our population growth rate is astonishingly high, given historical norms. We lived at less than 1 billion for most of our history, and only in the last 200 years have we added beyond that first billion, and now we're at 7 billion people. Given this extraordinary growth, do we have any idea what's going to happen? Let's take an example. 25 reindeer that were introduced to St. Paul Island, Alaska in 1910. This was an extraordinary example of population growth. From just a handful of animals, the population grew to nearly 2,000 in only 30 years. Exponential growth, but instead of reaching a stable carrying capacity, the population collapsed. And within 10 years, it had essentially gone extinct. What went wrong? The primary food, in fact, the only food for reindeer on this island, was a very slow-growing food source called lichen, which, as you know, is a combination of fungus and algae. And this grows incredibly slowly in such a harsh environment like Alaska. That's all the reindeer ate. They came to an island with abundance of food, life was great, but then they ate it all up. And once it was gone, there was nothing left, and the population collapsed. Now, this brings to mind one of the most famous influences on Charles Darwin in his formulation of natural selection. And this is from the Reverend Thomas Malthus, who in a pamphlet in 1798 famously wrote about the subject of population growth versus the means of subsistence. So in the case of the reindeer easily outstripped the number of lichen. What about us and our agriculture? So Malthus wrote, taking the population of the world at any number, the human species would increase in the ratio of 1 to 2 to 4 to 8. So he's talking about exponential growth, like any living thing. But then he says about subsistence, that subsistence would increase as 1, 2, 3, 4, so more arithmetic kind of growth. So then he says, in 2 centuries and a quarter, the population would be to the means of subsistence as 512 to 10. Population keeps doubling, but subsistence only increases linearly. In 3 centuries, as 4,096 to 13, and in 2,000 years, the difference would be almost incalculable, though the produce at that time would have increased to an immense extent. So he's recognizing that technology can help to increase our food supply, but he's assuming that technology only grows at a linear rate, whereas our populations inherently grow exponentially. Now, he said all this and recognized this as being an incredibly dangerous potential back in 1798 when the whole world population was still less than a billion. If we move forward 170 years to 1968, a famous American ecologist, Paul Ehrlich, wrote a book called The Population Bomb, in which he took Malthus's logic, applied it to what he knew about manufacturing and agriculture, and came up with some pretty dire predictions. He predicted that 4 billion people would starve between 1980 and 1989, including 65 million people in the U.S. By the year 2000, he predicted that the world would run out of oil, copper, iron, aluminum, and coal. Now, I don't know how many of you know people who starved to death in the U.S. between 1980 and 1989. I doubt you do. And you can look around you and you'll see plenty of oil and copper, iron, aluminum, and coal. He went on even more extraordinarily to say, if I were a gambler, I would take even money that England will not even exist in the year 2000. You may have been to England by now. If you haven't, I assure you, it's still there. Ehrlich was wrong. But this gave rise to a whole kind of alarmist view of environmentalism and ecology, where things are so desperate that the best thing you could do would be to kill yourself. Well, on the opposite side of this argument, which has now been raging for decades, we have businessmen, we have economists who like to say, oh, don't worry, Malthus is just as wrong as Ehrlich. This is crazy. And so here, Charles Perrings, an economist, wrote in 1987, the limits to growth may be adroitly sidestepped, just as they begin to loom menacingly. And then this great guy, Julian Simon, who said, we have in our hands now, actually in our libraries, the technology to feed, clothe, and supply energy to an ever-growing population for the next 7 billion years. Amazing. Okay, so in contrast to the doom and gloom of the environmentalists typified by Paul Ehrlich, we have this guy, Julian Simon, who is saying, oh, don't worry, it's always sunny, this is great, okay? Now, these guys are amazing in their optimism, okay? When Julian Simon was asked, well, you know, resources are bound to run out sometime, aren't they? I mean, when will we run out of oil? And he said, never. Okay, so we got two extreme views. We have Ehrlich, who incorrectly predicted the end of England by the year 2000, versus these guys who say that growth can go on forever. Well, let's look at some of these factors, and let's look logically at what the world would be like with constant growth. Let's take the stock market. 2008, we had a big stock market crash. People lost a lot of money. We had a big recession. But if you look at the annual growth rate from the stock market over 50, 60 years, or even a century, there has been about 4 or 5% growth each year. And that's made the stock market a nice investment. Okay? This has led to some people saying, oh, this can go on forever. The Dow Jones Industrial Average is about 16,000 right now. Some people say, oh, it could go to 36,000, 40,000, 100,000. I mean, how long can this growth continue? Well, let's do a simple thought experiment here. Let's imagine that you have $1,000 that you put in a bank account. And, you know, your parents may have told you it's a good idea to put your money in the bank, and you get compound interest, right? So you get 5% growth per year, and this is compounded. And so even though the first year you only get that $50, and the second year you get $53 added on, and so on, and this begins to multiply. And so you got exponential growth. And after 50 years, you have $11,000 from your original $1,000 investment. After 100 years, you'd have $131,000, okay? Now imagine that you had an ancestor who was incredibly clever and who had this idea that, you know, I'm going to have a great, 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 great grand descendant 1,000 years from now. I'm going to put $1,000 into the bank account for this lucky descendant way down the line. And we're going to get 5% growth for that whole 1,000 years. Do you know how much that would be worth? Do you have any idea how much that'd be worth after 1,000 years of just 5% growth rate? An enormous number. $1.6 trillion. That's more money than has ever existed on this planet. Okay? So even 5% growth rate is impossible over an extended period of time. Now, let's take organic growth. Let's talk about our own species. We have a current world population of about 7 billion people, and our rate of growth is only about 1% per year, so a lot slower than the stock market, but it's still growing. How long would it take for the human population to equal all the atoms in the universe? And this is a ridiculous limit because obviously you can't be a human being composed of just one atom, right? So we have to agree this is an absolute upper limit. Growth has to stop well before then, okay? So how long would it take at just 1% growth with an initial population of 7 billion? It would only take a few thousand years. The world's population would reach 3 times 10 to the 85th by the year 17,512, which is impossible. It's not a question of whether growth will sometimes reach a limit. It's just a question of when. And we already have signs that we're reaching the limits to how much our planet can actually support. So all I'm trying to say here is not to worry. England will probably still be there 30 years from now, but there's going to be a point somewhere where the human population will reach an upper limit.